Cutwork, a Needlecraft Mystery by Monica Ferris, narrated by Susan Boyce. Prologue. It was a few minutes after 10 on a warm June Sunday. Art on the Lake, Excelsior's annual art fair, had started yesterday, so those who simply had to come had already been, and the threatening weather today had made others decide to wait and see if it cleared. Still, it was a very popular fair in an attractive location. So when the rain started, there were several hundred shoppers wandering the outdoor aisles. Then thunder boomed, and the aisles cleared as customers hustled into the nearest booths for shelter. Betsy Devonshire was a member of the volunteer committee who ran the fair. A small business owner, she'd really been pressed to find time for the planning meetings, and because her needlework shop was open on Saturdays, she had only Sunday to offer her services. Deb Hart, chairman of the fair, had been ruthless with her schedule. Betsy had been in the service building on the common since daylight, which came very early in June. Artists could not open to the public until 10, but there was cleanup, rearranging, and restocking to do. The entertainers wanting to know where they could set up, and the food vendors needing to get cooking. Betsy had fielded a steady stream of artists and workers coming for the free donuts and coffee she had laid out for them on the counter, and to ask questions. Was it against local ordinances to? Could they run a line from? Was there a mechanic in town who could fix? Would she mind if the balloon artist stored his spare balloon inflator in here? Here was the information booth in a corner of a brick building in the southwest corner of the big field in which the fair was held. Betsy was surprised at the number of times she had to refill the urns and make more coffee. But with the approach of 10 o'clock and customers, the stream slowed to a trickle. Betsy unplugged and washed the coffee urns, put the 6 remaining donuts into a paper bag, then stocked a big refrigerator with soft drinks and the counter with T-shirts, both for sale to the public. The intense downpour cooled the air but raised the humidity and only dampened slightly the scent of broiled pork, popcorn, whipped fruit, hot dogs, blooming onions, and other delectables being sold from stands around the corner from her, out of sight but not nose. Right in front of Betsy, glittering under a wash of rain, was a big red fire truck, the kind with a cubicle back end. It was at the fair as a boast and exhibit. The art fair was sponsored in part by the Excelsior Chamber of Commerce, and the fire truck was new. Despite the rain, a few adults stopped to show the truck to their children, and a fireman in a yellow raincoat and helmet answered questions. Suddenly, the fireman jerked around and hurried to the front of the truck. He climbed up and in, and its engine roared to life. Adults and children scattered. A man appeared from the other side of the truck, hauling a toddler by his arm, splashing through a puddle hidden in the grass. No hard feelings. He laughed as he ran for the porch of Betsy's building, and the toddler, now over his shoulder like a sack of grain, was doing a happy imitation of the siren. Instead of coming back past the building to the street, the fire truck did a Y turn and went forward, down between booths, past the little band shell, toward the lake. Shelter seekers in the shell waved as it went by, but Betsy frowned. The only place the fire truck could go from there was along the lakefront. Surely none of the artist's booth could be on fire, not in this rain. So it must be a medical emergency. Here at the fair, or perhaps, thought Betsy, it's headed for the docks, where big excursion boats and smaller private craft tied up. People sometimes fell on wet decks or had heart attacks lifting sails. Betsy heard another siren approaching distantly. It got louder, then cut off. The sound seemed to come from the opposite end of the field, in the direction of the docks. Here and there, artists or their assistants were braving the storm to check guidelines. One stood on tiptoe, then hurried back inside to push up on his sagging roof and dump water off it. Another was replacing short tent pegs with long ones, kneeling in a big puddle to feel for the ground. His wristwatch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.